Emily Chang in San Francisco, and this is Bloomberg Technology. Coming up in the next hour, GameStop wraps its worst week ever. Still up since the start of the rally, but this week leaving an $18 billion hole. And biotech emerges as a new favorite of the retail investor crowd. What's next? Well, we'll look at what the memes are telling us. Plus, Bill Gurley is here, GameStop mania, and where is Robinhood getting it wrong? He was also one of the very first analysts covering Amazon back in the day. We'll ask him about Bezos stepping down. And space, the next frontier, privatization, exploration, innovation, regulation. We'll cover it all with the former head of NASA, Jim Bridenstine. All those stories in a moment, but first I want to get a look at the market. Stocks extending their weekly rally after weaker than forecast U.S. jobs data bolstered the case for President Biden's $1.9 trillion COVID relief package. For the full picture, let's bring in Bloomberg's Kriti Gupta. Kriti, walk us through the week.
Well, Emily, like you said, stocks ending the day in the green for a fifth straight session. That is extremely important to note. The biggest rally since the week right before that big tech wreck you saw back in September. Just look at the board here. The S&P 500 in the green, the NASDAQ outperforming. But what's not outperforming is the Philadelphia Semiconductor Index, that stocks index, taking a step back today. Let's take a look at the flip side, though. What outperformed? It was really those big tech stocks. Take a look at the New York FANG Index, just having a tear this week's 8%, nearly 8%, I should say, gains this week. And of course, you know, those are the heavyweights in the S&P 500 and the NASDAQ. So those, of course, helping those. But let's look under the hood, though. What tech companies in particular really helped this rally this week? And I just want to kick it off with Amazon. We know those stellar earnings across the board. And of course, talk of a new CEO, Google reliving some of its previous glory, relieving some of its investors of some of those digital ad concerns. Snapchat, same idea, and Activision, solid performance and growth in their franchise games, strong earnings beats across all four companies, and that really showed up in their stock performance this week. And that brings me to my last stock. I want to flip up the boards and look at a one-month chart of GameStop. Extremely important, you can't do a market check these days without talking about GameStop. Just look at the rally we've had, and then look how far we've fallen. At the peak there, Emily, we were up 2,000% in those shares, and now, just today, up 78% in its intraday peak. And then, of course, pulling back. Emily, this remains a fascinating story, and we'll just have to see what comes next week.
Absolutely, Kriti. I'm watching it every day. Thank you so much for that roundup. All right. Well, it may seem that the meme stock mania is dissipating after GameStop's $27 billion wipeout, there are still 16 companies with shares up triple digits this year. For more, I want to bring in Bloomberg's cross-asset reporter, Claire Ballantyne. Claire, Kriti touched on GameStop there, but if you look at the bigger picture overall, shares still up since this retail rally started. You know, what is jumping out to you right now about the latest turn?
Yeah, it's interesting because we have seen a lot of these stocks come back to earth, but sort of that story has sort of obscured the fact that so many of these are posting giant gains. Right now, after the close, seeing 17 of the original 50 stocks that were restricted by Robinhood posting more than 100% gains. It's pretty remarkable. Some of the ones that really stand out are GameStop, like you mentioned, Express, Naked Brands. The top one right now is Zomedica. It's a penny stock that was mentioned by Tiger King star Carol Baskin and really helped drive a rally in that stock. So it's pretty remarkable.
So how does Carol Baskin become, someone that the retail crowd listens to? What's actually going on inside these chat rooms?
Right. I think that just that story really underscores the fact that sometimes when these retail investors latch onto these narratives on Reddit boards and in chat rooms, it sort of just fuels this momentum. And in this case, you know, we saw Carol Baskin be a big star in 2020, really catch some eyeballs with just her name and mentioning, you know, this tiny little company in one of her videos just really spurred interest in it. So it's a fascinating dynamic in how these Reddit traders all kind of band together and drive up share prices.
Meantime, I'm sure you've got professional investors and hedge funds trying to figure out where this wave is going. Talk to us about the biotech rally that seems to be next and what's happening there.
Yeah, it's interesting to see sort of how professional investors kind of, grab onto this momentum or also are trying to grapple with what is going on with these stocks. And we have seen a lot of biotech companies do really well. I mean, that's, some of them are really key to some of the coronavirus developments. And it's interesting to watch these professional investors sort of follow retail investors sometimes, and then vice versa, obviously. So it's continuing to sort of play out.
So what are you watching next week, Claire? What should be on our radar?
I'm still really interested to see how this plays out. I mean, there's definitely been an unwinding of some of these retail favorite stocks. But, like we had talked about, a lot of them are up a ton. And, Reddit chat rooms, those aren't going away anytime soon. So I think a question on my team and just in our conversations is, what's going to be the next GameStop, the next AMC? Are we going to see these big pops again from these retail traders?
All right, you'll have to keep us posted. Bloomberg's Claire Ballantyne, thanks so much for that update. Coming up, the GameStop frenzy, Robinhood backlash, and Jeff Bezos stepping down. A lot's happened in tech in just the last couple of weeks. Longtime investor Bill Gurley of Benchmark Capital joins us to discuss his outlook next. This is Bloomberg. A bounce for shares of GameStop after Robinhood removed its limits on buying the stock did little to repair the now $18 billion hole left in the video game retailer for the week. GameStop wrapping up its worst week ever. Joining us now for more, longtime Silicon Valley venture capitalist Bill Gurley, who's been critical of some of the moves that Robinhood has made and watching all of these moves with great fascination. Bill, thanks so much for joining us. Okay, so GameStop down 80%. In a week. Is this just the beginning of a wild ride? And if so, where does it end?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, my literal answer would be I don't know. And this is one of the most fascinating things that's played out as the internet, intersects with finance. And a lot of people have highlighted or they believe that it's similar to social media's impact on elections and politics, right? And One of the most fascinating things is the groups of people it's brought together to seemingly stand behind one side or another. And so, I think AOC and Ted Cruz ended up, rooting for the same player here in this battle between the small investor and the giant hedge funds. What's super interesting is real damage was done to the big hedge funds. Like they took, big write downs in a market that's been, predominantly hot. And so that's interesting. I think the other super interesting thing is it's uncovered that people have been talking about there's a problem in the plumbing. I think there are lots and lots of problems in the plumbing that fester for years and create the dynamics that allow something like this to happen. The key question.
So let's talk about the problems in the plumbing and start with Robinhood. I know you've said their business model is based on a bizarre reality. Where do you think Robinhood is getting it wrong?
Well, their whole business model from the very beginning was to tell the user that something was free, and then to make money somewhere else. That somewhere else in this case is what's known as payment for order flow. And so the practice of payment for order flow is illegal in four other developed countries, UK, Canada, India, and Australia, and for a reason. It creates massive, enormous conflicts of interest. And what happens is when you put an order into Robinhood, they don't put it on the exchange, either the NASDAQ or the NYSE. They sell that order to six different companies that they work with who are really their customers. That's who pays them revenue. The largest being Citadel, but Virtu, there's several. And all that's disclosed. You can find it on Twitter, on the internet. And those people are even, in addition to kind of maybe, you know, choosing the bid ask they want to fill it at, they're allowed to front run the trade in their own account. And you know, I think it's misleading to the user to say something's free when you're probably those companies aren't paying for that order flow for no reason, right? Why you have to ask why are they paying for it? Well, they're monetizing it. And that has to do with giving you bad execution or front running your trade, which has the market moving away from you. And you imagine you get a whole bunch of people buying out of the money call options, and then you get the broker that's clearing those trades front running them, and you're going to create massive volatility like we saw.
So in that case, what should Robinhood do differently, or what should the SEC be doing about this?
Well, there are many arguments as to why you should ban payment for order flow and have people directly connected where you'd have more liquidity in the right place anyway. I was able to find a letter that Citadel, ironically, had sent to the SEC in 2004 where they did as good a job as any. They listed five detailed bullet points on the conflict of interest that come up and why payment for order flow should be banned. And I would, you know, encourage people to read that. The UK government also did a whole bunch of studies before they banned it in 2012, and they've studied it since and think they're in a way better place. So that's one. The second thing nobody's talking about, and there's really three things, but the second thing nobody's talking about is there are three different dimensions where Robinhood takes more risk than their competitors. One is use of margin. Two is encouragement of option activity. So the option trades relative to normal trades, much higher there. And then three, they let you trade before cash settles in your account. They like kind of forward you money. All three of those things directly affect the variables that go into the capital requirement commitment that they were forced to put up. But nowhere along the way did they say, oh, well, here's the calculation for that requirement, and here's why these actions that we take as a business are directly implicated there. And meanwhile, you know, those same things attract customers. So they have that problem in that they made themselves more interesting to people for those reasons, but it means more risk, and that's why the clearinghouse, you know, came down upon them. The third thing I was going to mention, just and we can wrap this up, but you know, it's now known that 64% of their revenue comes from options trading, and so the company wants you to believe and goes on public television and claims that their mission is to democratize investing, and I would say, you know, if this is mostly options trading, that's, you know, there's no book from Warren Buffett or Peter Lynch or any, you know, Burton McHale, who's a famous, that says, hey, the way to invest for the long term is trade options. No one's saying that. They would all dispute that. And so what Robinhood's really doing, I think, is kind of glorifying speculation. They're not democratizing investing.
So do you see a fundamental shift happening in market power from institutions to individuals? And if so, how should the strategy of professional investors be changing now that there are new rules? You always say play the game that's on the field, and it seems like the rules have changed.
Well, some of it will depend. I think that the new SEC commissioner is paying attention and Congress is paying attention, so we'll see, you know, whether things change that might eliminate some of the plumbing issues that might cause a future attempt like this to not work as well. They may also come up with regulation around not voicing that you like a stock or don't like a stock, but if you are intentionally giving instructions to people on how to manipulate liquidity in a stock, they may come down on that. And then the third thing that no one's asking is how much staying power does the Robinhood base really have? You just mentioned on the open $18 billion of market caps gone, you know, the hedge funds were cleared out by the time that happened. So who was left holding that right. bag? And how burned right. are they? You know? So the next push may not have as many soldiers left if there's lots of broken soldiers everywhere.
A lot of people lost a lot of money. I do want to get to, you've been a longtime proponent of direct listings, and we've seen a number of high-profile IPOs over the last couple of months. Airbnb, DoorDash, Affirm, Poshmark doubling or more than doubling on opening day. You know, I spoke to the CEOs of all of those companies on opening day. They're excited. Nobody said we got the price wrong. But what do you think? Do you see something wrong with that picture?
Oh, absolutely. I think all those companies could theoretically be held accountable for violating fiduciary duty. Selling the most valuable asset you own at half the market price, knowingly doing that, is just, it's ignorance. I don't think you will ever ask someone on the day of their IPO, did you just make a massive mistake, and have them say yes. So the reason I smiled when you brought that up, there's zero chance that's going to happen. So I'd probably
tell
you.
Is it the company, though, or is it the bankers?
Well, the problem is, and I have some data right here, like under first day underpricing in 2016, $2 billion, 17, $4 billion, 18, $7 billion, 19, $9 billion, last year, $30 billion. So the problem's getting ginormously worse. And then yesterday on the Hong Kong exchange, Kuaishou, $5 billion deal, $9 billion underpricing. On one deal. Look, the modern day best practice that the banks advise is they tell you you want to be 30x oversubscribed. Now, I think we could go back 400 years and find economists that would tell you how supply and demand affect price. And no one in 400 years of economics would suggest that the best practice would be to have a 30x supply-demand imbalance. Yet, every CEO, every CFO, every board member that talks to a bank in the 2 weeks going into their IPO, they're told that's what they're supposed to do. And they listen to that and say, oh, okay, that's great. It's plain stupidity. The great news is Commissioner Clayton on his way out the door approved, you know, and just an amazing, for me at least, you know, approved adding capital to a direct listing. And I fundamentally believe that, you know, 5-10 years from now, no one will adhere to this idiotic practice of giving away billions of dollars in a single day.
Wow. You never mince words, Bill, and that's why we love having you here. I do want to get to Amazon because you were the lead analyst on Amazon going back to the 90s. You posted a nostalgic tweet of a photo of you and Jeff Bezos from back in the day. You know, Andy Jassy is incredibly well-respected, but I wonder what risks do you think Amazon faces without Jeff Bezos at the helm? And is he really going to be able to hand over the reins and lean back, or is he going to be the backseat driver?
Yeah, I mean, I'll raise a provocative question that you might ask, you know, an Amazon executive, but it is my belief that you know, Jeff, clearly the best strategic thinker I've ever met around business strategy, but he has another superpower, which is he's able to take those ideas and systematize them. He's able to implement them in a company that now has over 1 million employees, and those practices are able to scale. And that's been what he's amazing at, right? Like, it's not just that he has the idea for AWS, it's that he can scale it so much. And so I think the optimist would say, you know, he hasn't struggled to take his genius and push it through the org and have the org absorb those best practices. And you know, a key, and so there's plenty of parts of Amazon where Jeff's not touching, you know, the day-to-day details. No human could. And so from that perspective, I would remain, you know, quite optimistic. I also think that in both of these huge businesses, they have remarkable strategic advantages at this point, probably higher even in the classic consumer business that they have.
So you think you're not worried about the regulatory issues?
I'm not. I mean, I think there's a lot more heat on other companies than on them on that front.
Okay.
It's, you know,
right,
I also
I, we
I
could talk very, to...
I have a very cynical view
final
on
thought,
regulation.
Final thought. We got to go, but I'll give you a final thought.
I have a very cynical view on regulation, and I have some interesting studies from Goldman and Morgan I've found to back it up, which is, you know, regulation's the friend of the incumbent. Most of the time when Washington, D.C. leans into a new industry, you lock in the incumbents, and the rules are written by the incumbents and make it very hard for new entrants to come up behind them. So I would say the more regulation, actually, the more you want to own the stock.
Interesting. All right. Well, I'm glad I let you say your point. Benchmark Capital's Bill Gurley, always good to have you here. Bill, thanks so much for stopping by. Coming up, we'll have more of Bloomberg Technology. This is Bloomberg. It is the biggest internet IPO since Uber went public in 2019. Shares of Kuaishou Technology rising 160% in their Hong Kong debut. The company operating one of China's most popular short video services. Kuaishou brought in $5.4 billion in the IPO. It attracted hundreds of billions of dollars worth of orders. And former New York Yankees star Alex Rodriguez. Yes. A-Rod has joined the SPAC craze. He's filed to raise $500 million for a special purpose acquisition company called SLAM. SLAM intends to pursue businesses in sports, media, entertainment, health, wellness, and consumer technology. Sounds like a lot of options there. And despite his background, the company says it does not intend to target pro sports franchises. All right, coming up, no more trips to the drugstore during a pandemic or snowstorms. We're going to hear from the CEO of Alto Pharmacy, which aims to compete with the likes of CVS, Walgreens, and the latest rival, Amazon Pharmacy. That's next. This is Bloomberg. Welcome back to Bloomberg Technology. I'm Emily Chang in San Francisco. President Biden's administration will be testing a program to provide COVID-19 vaccines directly to pharmacies, a move used to increase the pace of U.S. inoculations. Biden team saying they'll ship roughly 1 million doses a week to about 6,500 pharmacies nationwide as a trial run beginning February 11th. Joining us now to discuss, Matt Gamache-Aslin, co-founder and CEO of Alto Pharmacy, a telehealth pharmacy startup that's just expanded their services to serve 36 million customers across the United States. So first, Matt, tell us a little bit about how your model works and is different from the other options out there.
Absolutely. Thanks so much for having me, Emily. So really, Alto is a new kind of pharmacy where we do all of the work for you, right? So not only do we deliver to you same day for free as a patient, but we also help you save money on every single prescription, usually through really helping you navigate this really quite crazy world of health insurance and helping you optimize the price. And we have a whole team of clinical pharmacists that are really experts in your specific health condition. So you're not just talking to a generalist like you would at a typical retail pharmacy.
So nobody likes going to the pharmacy to pick stuff up, but you know, you're not the only ones creating an alternative. Amazon getting into the game with drug delivery, you know, how are you different?
Yeah, absolutely. So no, it's a $500 trillion market, right? It's a very large industry. And like any other large market, there's patients with a variety of needs. Amazon has their approach. They've been working at this for a few years now after the acquisition of PillPack. And you know, we're trying to provide an alternative where we really focus on this white glove, high level of care service, right? That really tries to take this community pharmacy feel that we all remember from many decades ago and bring that to the modern era. And so we don't, that's really through delivery, through this navigation of health insurance and this sort of higher touch of clinical care.
So what are your thoughts on the Biden administration sending shots of the COVID vaccine directly to pharmacies? Is that a good step forward?
Well, absolutely. I really think that the name of the game here is going to be distribution and access to the vaccine. Very quickly, we're going to have a lot of doses, and it's really, can we get this to as many people as fast as we can? I think probably much like everyone else, I'm very much looking forward to being out of this pandemic. So everyone that can help should try to be helping here. We're of course speaking with states and seeing how can we participate in that rollout, and we're making ourselves available to do anything and everything. And you know, this isn't really about economics here. It's just, can we be helpful in helping move the country through this? So I think the more we have points of distribution, the better.
So will Alto be getting any of those doses?
Nothing to announce right now, but we're working with states and all the states we operate in to see how we can best support and how we can help them.
So what, you know, in addition to vaccines, there are people needing drugs to fight COVID. I don't think we talk enough about treatment options once you get it. What sort of trends are you seeing there? What are we not talking enough about?
Yeah, frankly, I think one of the least talked about problems for people across the U.S. has been access to medications, the need to stay healthy, right? Very sadly, many of the most at-risk people to COVID are people that need the most medications, right? Think of diabetes, pulmonary diseases, cardio diseases, and you know, HIV positive and PrEP, which is another big area that we focus on. And those individuals who are very much at risk have had to go to pharmacies during COVID to pick up their medications, which is probably the last place they should be to stay safe. And so we've actually seen a big surge in patients from those areas. And we at the same time have actually built a lot of teams and infrastructure around doubling down on supporting those patients so we could make ourselves available. But you know, we've talked a lot about all the different drugs that you know, had reputations of helping with COVID throughout early this year. But really, in my mind, the patients we've left behind are really those that need to make these frequent trips to the pharmacy just to stay healthy.
So do you think that the physical pharmacy survives? What is your outlook on the future of a CVS and a Walgreens?
Yeah, I mean, frankly, I don't know I can predict the future here, but I think it's hard to see why a physical retail pharmacy is the right place for you to access those medications. I think, you know, both from a clinical expertise and just help on the insurance side and price optimization side, there's a lot you can do when you can specialize a workforce and have them really become expert at something smaller than every single medication, right? And you know, they're small items. People need them quickly, right? Which I think is why just mail isn't quite the right solution for pharmacy. But you know, today there's no real reason you can't have really any medication sent to you same day. So I think we're going to see that more and more move to kind of less in-person, less retail services. But you know, again, there's a lot that a Walgreens CVS does outside of just the health and the pharmacy space, which you know, that I'm sure will continue to be needs that people want to go in person for.
All right. Well, we'll keep watching. Alto Pharmacy co-founder and CEO Matt Gamache Aslin, thank you so much for joining us. Okay, coming up, Facebook and Apple's long history of rivalry, why the ongoing competition may actually benefit both companies. That is next. This is Bloomberg. All right, Bloomberg has learned that Apple has paused talks with South Korean car makers Hyundai and Kia about building an electric car. Sources saying Apple has also been discussing similar plans with other car makers. The secret project has ramped up in recent weeks. And of course, Mark Gurman knows all about it. Bloomberg's Mark Gurman with us now. So, Mark, what can you tell us?
Thank you for having me, Emily. So over the past week, there have been numerous reports claiming that Apple is in final discussions or nearing an agreement with Hyundai or Kia to develop an Apple electric car at a plant in Georgia or elsewhere. We're told, however, that these talks paused several weeks ago, and it doesn't appear that they are moving forward on any agreement anytime soon or potentially in the future.
So talk to us about how this fits into the longer journey that Apple has been on, with its car-making efforts. I know that there have been some twists and turns.
Starting in 2014, Apple set out to hire thousands of engineers to develop a car that would compete with Tesla at the time and launch around 2020 or 2021. There were many development challenges related to management of the project, self-driving, quality control, et cetera, back at the time. So they pared that back to focus just on the underlying self-driving car system. At the end of 2018, they hired Doug Field from Tesla, who ran the development of the Model 3. When he came back, he assessed the situation, and several months into that, he determined it was time for Apple to start going back to building a car. So last year, they formed a small team as part of this self-driving car effort to work on an actual car body, underlying car components, everything that goes into a car. And now they're at the point of exploring, hey, who are we going to work with, right? Are we going to work with, a big Italian car maker? Are we going to work with a German car maker, an Asian car maker, right? And so I feel like they're still in that situation where they're looking who they're going to partner with to manufacture it, or if they're going to do something more similarly to how they designed the iPhone and use a Foxconn to produce it.
Now, talk to us about how Apple's approach is different than other tech giants, of course, Google with its self-driving car technology that it's been working on for a really long time. Microsoft just announced a partnership with GM and Cruise to be the cloud behind their self-driving car efforts. What makes Apple different?
Yeah, so big differences here. So the Google partnership with Ford recently was about getting the Android operating system pre-installed into nav systems for, many of Ford's cars starting in 2023. The Microsoft portion is something similar there with other car makers. Google with Waymo, they focus very much on being sort of an Uber for the self-driving generation, whereas Apple is very much looking to take the Tesla approach. Same thing they do with all their products. They build this nice, pricey car, and they sell it, and you buy it, and you drive it. Or it drives you, actually, I should say. Whereas, Waymo is looking more towards a fleet. The big difference between Apple and Tesla is that Tesla is 100% all-encompassing. They design, build the cars. They do all their manufacturing. They do the battery production. Whereas you can expect the Apple car to be a mishmash of custom components from all over the global supply chain, just like any other Apple device.
So quickly, Mark, while I have you, I know you've been looking into the relationship between Apple and Facebook. They've been getting increasingly publicly testy about one another. You've been looking into how they actually potentially benefit from the tension in their relationship. How?
So this has been a mutually beneficial relationship for many years, right? Apple sells phones or keeps people going to other platforms by, allowing, despite all the issues with Facebook, it to continue being on the platform. Whereas, Facebook has made so much ad revenue over the years by having access to those over 1 billion iPhone users and other device users. So it's mutually beneficial, but, the tension is heating up, and it will continue to do so over AR and VR in the years to come.
All right, Bloomberg's Mark Gurman, thanks so much for your analysis there. We'll continue to watch your reporting. Now, sticking with perhaps the biggest tech story of the week, I'm joined by our Bloomberg senior executive editor, Brad Stone, who's been continuing to cover Jeff Bezos, announcing he will be stepping down from Amazon later this year to be replaced by Andy Jassy. Brad, we talked the day this happened. You were surprised. We all were surprised. Over the last few days, what have you been finding out about why Jeff Bezos is stepping down now?
Yeah, I was sort of shell-shocked the day we spoke. I think everybody was. Here's someone, an internet icon, who has probably been the most successful and effective internet CEO, maybe even in history. And now a couple of days have passed, and you look back, And it seems natural in a way that he's done this. I mean, first of all, what I really sort of learned in researching his activities over the past few years is he has been stepping away. He's been very involved in the new products at Amazon, the Echo, the Project Kuiper, their effort to put satellites into space to provide internet access, the healthcare efforts at Amazon. But he's really been stepping away from the older businesses, the more mature businesses like retail and AWS, and letting folks like Andy Jassy run them somewhat autonomously. So in a way, this is a formalization of the status quo at Amazon. Another indicator is for the last year, he hasn't had a shadow or a TA, a technical assistant, the executive at Amazon who tended to follow him around. Jassy was Bezos's first TA at Amazon. The fact that Bezos hasn't had one, a role that's been so integral to his innovation and effectiveness at Amazon, was really an indication that he was beginning to step back and focus on those other efforts like his philanthropy, Blue Origin, and the Washington Post.
Now, this is a question that has occurred to me over the last couple of days, which is how easily do you think he will step away? And do you think he's actually going to give Andy Jassy the space to lead? We've seen some difficult CEO changeovers, whether it's Bill Gates to Steve Ballmer or Mark Benioff taking on a co-CEO who's no longer the co-CEO. How do you expect that transition to happen in practice?
I personally think it'll be smoother than the other examples that you've mentioned. You know, for one, he has been kind of scaling back over the last couple of years. In fact, really over the last 20 years, what he's been so effective at is putting together a culture and a system of invention at Amazon. And he's kind of laid the groundwork. It's like he wound up the robot and then he's let it go and it's walking by itself. I think that's, in fact, one of probably his most incredible accomplishments, creating the culture of innovation at Amazon. And he's let his deputies kind of operate very independently. He's not going to detach altogether, right? He's going to remain active in the new products. He's going to sit on the S team, and I imagine he'll be reviewing kind of the major decisions like acquisitions. But over the past few years, he really hasn't shown that much of an interest in meddling with, for example, AWS and the way Andy Jassy runs it. In fact, you know, there are a couple of examples of AWS acquisitions where he has not quite seen the reasoning and argued maybe against it, but then ultimately netted out by saying to Andy Jassy, "This is your business. I trust your judgment." And I think that's probably on some big stuff what I'll start to do. And remember, this transition doesn't formalize until the third quarter. So again, it's going to be a gradual pulling back by Jeff Bezos.
Jeff Bezos famously writes these question mark emails where he like forwards an email to the team and all he says is question mark. And then everybody scurries trying to figure out what he's asking and give him some kind of additional context. How do you expect Andy Jassy to lead? Is he going to be a question mark email kind of guy or something else?
Well, he has been actually doing that from within AWS. So I expect he'll now do it for the entire business. But you raise a good question, which is, will Jeff Bezos continue to send those emails? And something I've wondered, and I don't have the answer, so I'll just pose it. Will he continue to write his famous annual shareholder letter every spring that goes out with the annual report? I don't know. That'll be interesting to watch. Will Jeff continue to do that, or will Andy Jassy take it over? I suspect Jassy will take it over, but we won't find out that for another year.
All right. Brad Stone, our senior executive editor, really appreciate your perspective on this, and we'll continue to watch your analysis and your reporting as well. Okay, coming up, I am speaking with former NASA Administrator Jim Bridenstine at the Space Agency under the Trump administration, where his sights are set for future space exploration. Next, this is Bloomberg. Space exploration. Well, you might be seeing a lot more of it. With SpaceX on track to launch the first ever civilian space flight later this year and other rocket companies announcing they are going public, it seems the space sector is getting a new look. With me now, no stranger to it, Jim Bridenstine, former NASA administrator under the Trump administration and now a senior advisor at Acorn Growth Companies, where he will be investing across the sector. Jim, thank you so much for joining us. I want to start with the civilian space mission. We talked with Jared Isaacman yesterday, the CEO who will be leading that all-civilian mission. And I'm curious whether you think that that is something that NASA should be regulating when it involves civilians going into space, even with a private company.
So I don't think so. NASA is an agency that does exploration, discovery. Of course, we do human spaceflight. But when it comes to human spaceflight by the private sector, I think there are other agencies that are in fact more capable of doing regulation than NASA. NASA is about science and discovery. We are not at NASA, and I say we. Of course, I'm not at NASA as of the last 2 weeks, but NASA is not a regulator, and I think we should be careful to not get NASA mixed up in that kind of activity.
I'm curious what you've seen so far, what your thoughts are on what you've seen so far from the Biden administration regarding space exploration, the White House saying that the president does support a mission to the moon. You know, I know that you were supportive of getting all the way to Mars. Do you think the Biden team is missing something here?
No, I think they are doing the right thing. I am actually quite pleased and excited about the Biden administration coming out and saying that they support the Artemis program and fully embracing the idea that it's time to land the first woman on the surface of the moon. That's an idea whose time has come. There have only been 12 people that walked on the moon. They were all white men. And now at NASA, there is a very diverse, highly qualified astronaut corps that includes women, and it represents all of America. And I would just say I'm very proud of the Biden administration for embracing the Artemis program. A lot of people might not realize Artemis in Greek mythology is the twin sister of Apollo, and she was the goddess of the moon. So we think about, here we are 50 years after the Apollo program, we're going back to the moon, and of course this time we're going with all of America, and we're doing it with a purpose, and that is to get to Mars. The moon is the proving ground. It's how we learn how to live and work on another world for long periods of time, and then we take all that knowledge to Mars. And so the fact that we went from one administration to the next and we kept that continuity moving forward, I just really think that's great. And I think, you know, that's the kind of unity that America can respond to and be enthusiastic about.
Now, every time I look at the night sky, I see more satellites in space. And I wonder, with all of this new exploration, all of these new satellites in our orbit, are you at all concerned about the amount of debris? Like, in some future life, could we trap ourselves on Earth given how much is now up there?
Absolutely. We are seeing constellations being launched into space now for basically low Earth orbit, for low latency, high throughput communications, which is absolutely great, because it's going to transform how we do communications. It's going to connect the world. That other half of the world that is not connected is now going to be connected. All that is wonderful for humanity. The challenge is, you know, we have seen orbital debris continue to grow. And of course, if we damage low Earth orbit, we can't get it back. It's going to be damaged forever. So it has to be preserved. We need to be responsible. I will tell you, the companies that I know that are doing these activities, they are focused on responsibility, but there absolutely has to be a government response that says, here are the rules by which everybody will operate. We need better space situational awareness. We need space traffic management. We need space debris remediation capabilities. How do we get the debris out of space? And we need everybody to be very responsible when it comes to space debris mitigation. If we do all of those things, which right now we're not where we need to be, but if we do all of those things, space will be preserved for a long time and humanity will be made much better off.
So just 30 seconds left, Jim. Now with Acorn, where do you think they should be placing their bets in this sector? Quickly.
Yeah, so we see the space environment is now more investable than ever before. It used to be the place for billionaires. Then venture capitalists got involved in it. And now it's moving into private equity. What does that mean? That means that there are stable cash flows. There are stable revenues. Space is now investable at the private equity level. And, of course, we're seeing a lot of companies go public. So I really think this is a great time to be in, to be investing in commercial space.
All right. Jim Bridenstine, so great to have your perspective. Former NASA administrator, thank you so much for taking the time to join us. We'll be watching to see where you place your bets in the great beyond. And that does it for this edition of Bloomberg Technology. I'm Emily Chang in San Francisco. Happy Friday, everyone. Have a wonderful weekend. We'll see you back here on Monday. This is Bloomberg.